Reggie Wu is a music teacher here in Voorhees, New Jersey, who once played in a band, and now I'm just trying to find life after rock and roll. My mom's a classical piano teacher, and it's all about music in the house. Like, 4 years old, they started me on classical piano lessons, and it was the law. You had to do it, and in third or fourth grade, you had to pick a second instrument. Took the violin, hated it, took a couple years of that, finally made the transfer to guitar, and it's been guitar ever since. Guitar is probably my favorite.
I was like, my parents,
that of the two or three,
were like, practice every day. You have to do a couple hours of everything, and they were like, practice. And about ninth grade, I was really dorky all through like elementary school, and all of a sudden, like in middle school, seventh, eighth grade, I started getting more popular for being this Chinese kid who could play the guitar. So obviously, I'm going to gravitate towards my guitar. So ninth grade, I said, I want to be a musician. And my parents were like, no, you have to be a doctor. You have to be a lawyer. I'm like, what are you talking about? You just hammered me my whole life musically. And now, you know, that everyone took it as I was rebelling. And I might have been rebelling a little bit, but this is what I knew in ninth grade, that's what I was going to do the rest of my life with music. Well, being the firstborn from a Chinese, first generation Chinese family, it's all about education. I can honestly say every one of my peers in the Chinese community, my brothers and sisters, they're all doctors or lawyers, they're all successful right now. Like I said, in ninth grade, I wanted to be a musician, and my parents thought I was rebelling, and that's when things got nasty. And I stopped going to school so I could stay home and practice, and obviously you can't do that. And I would do everything I could to get suspended, and so I could stay home and practice my guitar, because back then it was out of school suspensions. You're suspended. I'm like, thanks. You know, I'll stay home. And my poor parents just were mortified that, you know, the firstborn son, while everybody else's son is doing great, is just failing out of school. But I knew what I wanted to do. So I got expelled. I got sent to a school where the kids were really bad. And kids that were like, you know, bad kids. Although now I talk to them, you know, on Facebook, and everybody's doing great. But, you know, back then I was scared. I was like, oh my God, like, I'm kicked out of high school, and I'm already playing clubs now. And so my parents were like, that's it, you're out. You're not doing it our way, you're doing it your way, so you're out, you're on your own. Moved out of my parents' home when I was 16, which is pretty young. Moved into a person's house, rented a room, and he was my boss. We cut lawns every day. I was a landscaper, you know, all manual labor, and you know, couldn't rub two pennies together. You know, shoplifting food for food. You know, we joke about it now. Magazines for toilet paper. I mean, but it was all in fun. You know, I was the only dude who had an apartment at 16 years old. You know, right out of high school, bam, into the bands. I know that this is it full time, but you know, me and Lisa were together, and she comes from a very successful family, not wealthy at the time like they are now, but her father was you know, vice president at RCA, like very successful corporate, and he's just like, what the hell is my daughter dating this guy for? You know, we've been together since I was 18 and she was 16, And here we are, we're getting, you know, we're serious, and I moved to California, and the plan was for Lisa to come out there and meet me out there, and I went out to California, the band fell apart, came back with my tail between my legs, and just kept playing in bands, cutting lawns, construction, until her father was just like, okay, we got married early, had Ashley early, you know, at least it was 22, I think, you know, I was 24, and he's just like, okay, you need a job, and gets me this great job at RCA, where I'm wearing a suit and tie, and I'm getting paid great, the best money I've ever made in my life, and benefits, and I'm hating life. I'm just like, I cut off all my hair, and I'm hating life, and that's when the band Heaven's Edge, I guess, started taking off. And it's funny, because I started growing my hair long, all about the hair back then, and they call me and they're like, you know, we have an image to have here. You can't be growing your hair long. And so I went out and bought, at the time, it was this $150 short wig. Put my hair in a hair test. It's like, oh my God, that's my son-in-law. Always just played in bands, moved to California. But everywhere I moved, it was always keeping an eye out for people that I thought that were good. And there was this singer, Mark Evans, that was in the biggest band here in Jersey. They were a cover band, and they were great. And I was like, I need that dude. I gotta get that guy. And everyone said he would never leave it. Network, that was the name of his band. And I asked him, we started writing on the side, and we had instant chemistry. And 80 songs later, right out of the box, it was Mark from Heaven's Edge, and I had a pretty big name. So right out of the box, we we broke all the attendance records everywhere we played, just because we were both popular and wanted to see this group. So we had a good start. But I mean, prior to that, I guess Heaven's Edge started when I was like 25. I mean, we were poor. We had nothing, you know. We were just playing in bands all over Jersey, Philly. I remember driving like to Ohio to play like a 2,000 seater place, and there was like six people there, you know, like crazy things like that. But you did whatever, and it was all fun. I'd do it again in a second. But here in the Philadelphia tri-state area, we were huge. We were like selling out everywhere we went. And this is even before the record deal. And once we hit the record deal, things just blew up. Five guys were in the band. I mean, like I said, the climb was super easy compared to any other groups I was in. But we got approached by seven labels. Well, we sent out our demo. We went to Boyz II Men studio to cut our demo. And we sent out our demo, which was a three-song demo, and we got seven labels interested right off the top. This magazine called The Hard Report gave us a great write-up saying, oh, we're the next thing out of New Jersey after Bon Jovi and Cinderella, and we were psyched. And that next day, like, seven labels came and said, we want to come see the band. So they set up a showcase at the Troc, and our managers came in and said, we invited seven labels, you're lucky one will show up. And so don't get your hopes up, guys, but just go out there and have a great show. Right before we went on, they said all seven are here. After we got done playing that night, all seven people were in our dressing room. They all knew each other like any business, and they were all fighting over us. It was crazy. Atlantic, Columbia, Epic, like all these labels. We got verbal offers from all seven labels in one night, and we chose Columbia, which ended up being the wrong one, but it's all good, you know, it's all for a reason. But they came to us, and they were getting smoked by a company called Polygram that had Bon Jovi's Def Leppard, Cinderella, and they said to us, we want you to be our Bon Jovi. And so we went with Columbia, and a series of events set off our downfall. But starting with WMMR had a huge celebration for us, and it was a party. And that night at the Empire Rock Room, after we were done playing, it was like 2 o'clock in the morning, some crazy guy who had gotten kicked out earlier in the night said, I'm coming back and killing everybody. And he came back with the shotgun, and as my bass player opened the door to leave, to go home, he got hit with the sawed-off shotgun, which sprays you with like pellets. And that right off the top pushed our album back, 6 months, a year. And in that time was when Nirvana and Pearl Jam hit, and so by the time our record came out finally, our time had passed, our little window had passed. And Donny Einar was brought over from Arista. He was responsible for Whitney Houston's success, came over to Columbia, and absolutely just hated us. That was like, he hated us, and to his credit, he knew that our music was on the way out. You know, he brought in a man called Alice in Chains, who I was just like, ah, these guys are awful. And now they're like one of my favorite bands, you know, like I was so blind with, I guess I was just burnt, I was bummed. But and Alice in Chains went on to just sell gazillions of records, and Donny Einar obviously made the right choice, and funny thing is, we went back to all those six other labels, and they were all like, stay away, you guys are the band that flopped with Columbia after they put in all the money. And so it was crazy. It's like I worked all those years, we get the record deal, things are great, and like within a year it fell apart. The shows were the best part, because no matter where we went, it would just be packed. And it was just like, I remember pulling up to the track in Philly, and there'd just be a line around Ray Street, around the block, and it was a lot of fun. Can't do it because you love it. You have to just play music. I can honestly say I've only been in a band, I've only played music because I love music. If I had to do it all over again, I would do it all over. You can't do it because you want to be a rock star. You have to just truly do it because you love making music and you want to get your music out to people. And you have to be passionate every day. You have to live, breathe, die music. You can't think about anything else. You have to, every day, say, how can I take that next step to promote my career? And you have to work on marketing yourself. With the internet, it's so powerful now. You could do it that way. Obviously, you have to practice your craft. You have to be a maniac. I think at the top of my game, I was doing like 6 hours a day on the guitar. And that was nothing because I had friends that were doing 10 hours a day. But I was married and I had a family. I had Ashley. I had the kids. And, you know, I couldn't play the guitar 10 hours a day and then go play with the band. I think the difference between Heaven's Edge and the other bands is we never thought from day one we were going to fail. We knew we were going to be successful. And it was five guys all thinking exactly the same, because you don't get that a lot. It's like being in five marriages, and it was five guys who we all had a common goal, and I know everybody has the common goal, but you have to be taking the steps all together to make it. Really, you know, it shows that, you know, music can be something really good, and for 90% of the kids, they're just doing it for fun, you know, and it's funny. I remember I actually had a party here, and I don't even know if I'm going to put this part on, but one of her friends came up to me and was just like, Mr. Wu, this is when you guys were in college, and he's like, you got to teach me guitar because guitar is the greatest panty dropper in college. I'm like, what are you talking about? You're friends with my daughter? So everyone has a reason for the wanting to play music, you know, and but then I'll just never forget that. I mean, music is the universal language. It really, no matter where you go, there's going to be music. You have a bad day, you know, you come home, like, the greatest thing, Ashley graduated college and said, Dad, I want to take piano lessons, you know, I was just like, oh, you know, it's just, you have a bad day, you can sit down at the piano and just noodle, and it just makes you feel better, you know, whether you're great or not, and that's all I look for my family, you know, as far as I just want them to enjoy music.